SHA stands for the Secure Hash Algorithm, which is interesting given that it's just kind of been broken. But I'm not going to talk specifically about the attack on SHA today. That's for a different video. But what I wanted to do was talk in a little bit more detail about hash functions and what they are, and how SHA in particular works, so you can get an idea of the kind of way these things are implemented. Let's have a quick look at what a hash function is, briefly, because Tom Scott's already covered it in his video, and he's gone into a lot of the reasons you might use a hash function. The kind of hash functions I'm talking about are not the ones that we've been talking about for hashing passwords. Those ones have to be quite slow, in some sense, because you need them to be secure. We're going to talk mostly about the hash functions that are used routinely in cryptography for things like message authentication, digital signatures, and so on. So they need to be fairly quick, both to verify and compute. A hash function takes some string, right, let's say A, B, C, and it turns it into some fixed length string, but it's not usually three long, of random. So, you know, a bit string, right, but so you know, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, dot, dot, dot. Going forward this way for however many bits that hash function is. Now, there's a few important properties of hash functions that we care about for cryptography, but the most important one perhaps is that it's essentially pseudo-random. So that means that we put in ABC and we get out something that is in no way like ABC and appears completely random to us. And if we change this even slightly, because it's appearing random, this is completely changed. So let's have a quick look at SHA-1 as an example, just so we can see this in action. I'm on some page that has a script that calculates hashes on the fly. So I can put in ABC and you can see that the hash is A999, 3E, and so on all the way up to D. Right, this is the SHA-1 hash. A SHA-1 hash is 160 bits long. If I change this C to a D, the hash is completely changed. So there's the appearance of randomness, the idea that this hash is actually not related to this at all, even though it is. And we know it is because if I put C back again, we're back to A9993. So we can use this to verify messages haven't been changed or verify signatures on certificates. And we can do it knowing that we have the appearance of randomness, but actually it's not random at all. Today we're going to talk a bit about how you actually write a hash function to do this. How do we take something that essentially isn't random with a very known structure and turn it into something that looks like nonsense such that we can use it? Now, there'll be people raising a few eyebrows that I'm using SHA-1 as an example to do this, but actually there's fairly reasonable reasons to do so. First of all, you know, we might also talk about the weaknesses at some point. But also, SHA-1 bears a striking similarity in structure to MD4 and MD5, which have seen a lot of use historically, and SHA-256 and SHA-512, which is SHA-2, which currently is in some sense the standard that everyone uses. Right? SHA-3 is quite different, and that is something else for another day. So SHA-1 was developed by the NSA and released and published in 1995. Now, a lot of people don't trust things that the NSA do, sort of by default, which might be fair, but in this case, actually SHA-1 was quite good for a long, long time. There were some concerns, more recently, much more serious concerns, but originally the NSA weren't doing it as a backdoor and stuff. The NSA need cryptography just like everyone else, and this was a good function. MD5 had a lot of problems, and so what they basically did was extend it and make it better. SHA-1 takes any length of string and outputs a 160-bit value, right? So that's 160 zeros and ones. The question then becomes, I've got a string that could be ABC, or it could be an incredibly long file, or, you know, a whole movie, right? And I want to calculate a 160-bit signature of that. How do I even get started doing that? Well, the answer is that I basically have a loop that takes 512-bit blocks of data, one at a time, until the file's expended. Let's look at an example of how SHA-1 works on just a single message of exactly the right length, and then we'll just talk briefly about what you do when inevitably isn't the right length, which is almost always. Right? So SHA-1 takes a message in blocks of 512 bits in length. And if it's only one block, if the message is exactly 512 bits in length, then we only run it once, in essence, and then we output the hash at the end. So SHA-1 starts with an internal state. Then we bring in bits of our message one at a time and we change that internal state. And after we've done that, at the very end, when there's no more message left, we just read what the internal state is, and that's our hash. Right? So we're going to basically be taking the internal state and updating it with the message until we run out of message. And then as soon as that process stops, we can read the result. That's how the SHA family of hash functions works. So our internal state we call H. So I'm going to say H naught H H2, H3, and H4. Now, the internal state of SHA-1 is exactly the same length as the hash that it produces, which is 160 bits, which is 5 32-bit words, 4 bytes each. You know, for 32-bit machines, this would be an int. So this is initialized based on some constants, which are defined in the standard. Right? We might talk about that in a bit, but it's not very important. And what we're going to do is we're going to update these H's as we bring in our message, and then at the end, we'll see what the H's are, and that's our hash function. So how do we do this? Well, we have something called a compression function that's going to take in this data and a bit of message, turn it into another set of H values, and that's going to repeat as we have a message. But that's only going to happen once this time because my message is exactly 512, which is very handy. So this is our compression function, and I'm going to rename these slightly just to confuse everyone to A, B, C, D, and E. So at the beginning of our compression function, we copy the internal state into A, B, C, D, and E. We then perform 80 rounds of SHA compression function, right, which is like this, so times 80. Now, what that's going to do is take in words from our 512-bit block of our message. So if this is our message here, our message is 512 bits. This is going to come in at this point and be mixed in with this A, B, C, and D. So well, for now, we won't talk about exactly what's going on in this compression function. But the idea is that the bits of A, B, C, D, and E are being combined together, they're being shuffled, they're being permuted around to make it look more and more random as we go. And at the same time, we're bringing in bits from this message to further increase the appearance of randomness, but also to make sure that this SHA function is calculating a digest on this specific message rather than just a general one that's the same every time. For this message, we're always going to perform the exact same algorithm. So if we put in this message a second time, the SHA function will produce exactly the same result. Now, once we've done this and we've shuffled up A, B, C, D, and E, we'll be left with a new A, B, C, D, and E. So A, B, C, D, and E. And then we finish this block by bringing our H values down here and adding them to these values here to create a new H0, H1, H2, H3, H4. The state has now been updated by whatever we did in this compression function by just adding to it. Right? Now, all addition in SHA is done without any overflow, modulo 2 to the 32. What that means is that if you ever go over the maximum value allowed by a 4-byte integer, you wrap back around again, right? Which is one of the reasons why SHA can't be reversed, because you might lose information that way. This is not encryption, we don't need to be able to reverse it. So this state is finished. Now, if our message is exactly 512 bits, we read these H0, H1, H2, H3, H4 values out. That is our hash. So for short messages, we're done. I can just, you know, go home. In actual fact, the principle of extending this to arbitrary length messages, right, in increments of 512 bits, is we copy this state back up to the top and we repeat the process. And then we copy it back up and we repeat the process for as many blocks as we have of our message. 512 bits at a time of our message, we feed it in, we alter the state using this approach here, and then we read off a state when we're done. Right? That's basically how it works. So the security of SHA is all in this compression function and what it's doing.
If it's shorter than that,
yeah.
What happens there?
If it's not a multiple of 512 bits, we're going to have to do some padding, right? SHA only works with 512-bit blocks. So what we do is if we have our message, which is, let's say, 10011101. This is not a very long message. If we want to pad that up to 512 bits, we start with a 1. We pad using 11, right? So I'm going to just sort of demarcate the padding here so we know. We go with 0000, and then we finish off the message with the length of the actual message in it so we know where to sort of remove the padding, which in this case is 7, so in binary 111. So 111. Obviously would a lot more bits for your length than I have done, right? But you get the idea. Now, this padding scheme ensures that messages of the same length and messages that end in the same way or in very similar ways don't share the same padding and don't end up it being the same. That's very important. So this approach to SHA, this repetitive updating of the internal state with a compression function, is in essence is called a Merkle-Damgård construction. This was sort of independently proved by Merkle and Damgård. But essentially, what's good about it is if your compression function is good and has good pseudo-random properties, then so does your SHA function, which is of course very useful, right? The problem is that the compression function of SHA-1 is not so good that the attacks are 2 to the 80. They can be reduced somewhat to about 2 to the 60, something like this, which becomes into the realm of possibility for people with a lot of money.